This will be our third lesson in the book of Philemon. This will be a little different kind of approach than I normally take, and I will not do this type of thing very often. But you'll see why I'm doing it as we proceed. Now, in Christ Jesus, that's the only kind of life, really, I want to investigate and analyze. There's a certain awareness, or you might call it cognizance, of God and His will is developed. It's something you grow into it. You can live so the most dominant thing you think about are the circumstances that surround you. You can live like this. This is not the way to live. And everyone is actually tempted to do this. Your own circumstances, they may be joyful ones, they may be sad ones, they can consume you. And when they do, they throw you off. Because your life really isn't about you. Let's be right frank about it. You've got to get to the point where you don't care all that much about what happens to you. I know that doesn't sound right, but that's the truth. You actually have got to have more concern for the other first person than for yourself. In honor, preferring.
That's right.
We got a word on this. This isn't something we're guessing about. In honor, preferring one another.
That's right.
That's the secret to knowing the Lord. Or shall I say a secret to knowing the Lord, that as soon as you're wrapped up in yourself, God is way off there in a corner someplace. That's just the way it is. Now, this matter of having a consciousness of God or awareness of God, a sense of His presence, a sense of His will, this all comes under the heading of knowing God. That's the general heading. And that's something that's common to everyone that's in Christ. They shall all know me. Now, some know Him better than others know Him. When you experience that in life, there's some people, you have a circle of friends, but you know some of them more extensively. To know the Lord means like you are an authority on what God likes. You want to know what God likes? You can ask one of His people that's informed. They can at least give you some illumination. Or what is God repelled by? Well, see, when you know the Lord, you can give some information about that. And there are some things that repel God,
Amen.
That make Him draw back from you. Yeah, there are. So knowing the Lord, that all is involved in that. See, when you're familiar with God and His ways, that changes how you live. It does. If you don't know God and His ways, that affects how you live also. So when you're familiar with God's ways and God's person, it directs how you think, how you talk, how you act. So when you see people living in an unacceptable manner, like, you don't have to ask them, do you know the Lord? They don't. That's why they're living that way.
Amen.
If you find someone has a well-ordered life, a God-glorifying life, you don't have to ask them, do you know the Lord? That's why they're living that way. It's because they do. Now, under the law, this kind of familiarity with God was unknown. It didn't exist. If it did, it wasn't because of the law. It was because of the faith of people. But under the law, no matter how much the people were exposed to God, he might have talked directly to them, worked right under the nose, did some astounding miracle in their presence, no matter what he did or what he said, it didn't change the people. They still didn't prefer God. The first chance they'd have, they'd run off after some other god. even after all God did. Like, God has never worked the miracles on the level he did with Israel. He never has done that with anybody else, including the church. I say including the church. So far as an outward, nothing parallels their deliverance from Egypt or crossing the Red Sea or manna for 40 years or water out of a rock. Or nobody has ever been blessed like that. But there are still people who think if they were, that it changed the way they think. It changed the way they live. No, it wouldn't either.
Amen.
God could pour out a bundle of blessings on you and it would not alter you one bit, not one iota, if your heart wasn't right toward him when you didn't know him.
Can you get it?
Yes.
We can see an example of this with the multitude that followed Jesus for the free meals.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah.
Amen. Yeah, those same people left him when he said, except you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no life in you. And he never did explain to them what he meant. He didn't explain it to his disciples either. You either figured it out or you didn't get it. Sometimes Jesus teaches that way. Yeah, you can read books, you can consult with somebody else, but he says some things that you got to figure it out. You have to figure it out. If he said, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, if you don't figure that out, you'll never see it, because he never did tell his disciples what he meant.
Yeah.
But they figured out, oh, he's talking about the doctrine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I really think there's a lot of people that have never really seen that. They're always looking for a shortcut to spiritual understanding. Now, Israel, back to Israel, I'm making a point here that under the law, knowing God was not possible, not because of the law. If anyone did know God, it was not the result of the law.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Under the law, the people of God were described as rebellious, stiff-necked, disobedient, gainsaying, impudent, and hard-hearted, foolish. That's a description of the people of God that he chose, that he delivered. That's the description of some people he delivered and saved. That's the description of them. And they provoked the Lord to anger. God's around him, he'd get angry. There's still people like this.
Yes.
There's still people like this that make God mad. Just their person irritates God.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That doesn't sound like the real God. Well, you better be taking up your Bible and getting acquainted with it. Because there's a lot of people that could tell you, oh yeah, we can tell you. You can make God so angry, just take your life. Just won't allow you to live anymore. We're talking about knowing God. See, under the law, they couldn't pick up on this. The law said a lot about God, but they couldn't pick up on it at all. They moved God to jealousy. No wonder the law was called in 2 Corinthians 3:7, the ministration of death. Engraved upon stones. Yeah? The Ten Commandments killed people.
That's right. Amen.
That doesn't sound right. I don't care if it sounds right or not. It says the ministration of death. It administered death.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
It took people's lives.
Uh-huh.
Why? Because it made sin worse.
Yeah.
Sin through the commandment became exceedingly. I'm explaining to you why people under the law didn't know God. It's also called the ministration of condemnation, 2 Corinthians 3:9. It condemned people because it gave no leeway. It said, this is what you're supposed to be. This is what you can do, must do. This is what you must not do. And if you have one failing, condemned. That's it. It was a ministry of condemnation. So people that have a propensity to law, and I am ashamed of it, but I was once identified with this kind of people. with this kind of movement. It was kind of a law movement. It's what it was.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Actually, all false religion is a reversion to law in some way. You take, for instance, the radical part, keeping the commandments and looked from carnal. But then there's another. The charismatic movement is a movement of law. They just focus around the baptism of the Holy Spirit and speaking in tongues and things like this, but it's a movement of law. And what happens? It agitates sin. And the people aren't acquainted with God. If there's exceptions. I understand there's exceptions, but that's all systems of law. I'm sorry that being under law doesn't always appear harsh. Sometimes it appears otherwise, but it's where you're looking for God to make you different. Maybe you go through a procedure where God will just make you think different and all. But this isn't the way it happens. God does have a new creation, but it's done through Christ and through faith. In the declining condition, Israel very rarely sought God. If they did seek God, it was during severe duress of some kind. Now we're going to behold Paul and Philemon. Paul and Philemon are going to exhibit the nature of the new covenant, which is properly called, as compared to the ministration of death, it's called the ministration of the Spirit, which gives life. That's 2 Corinthians 3:9, 3:8. And it's called the ministration of righteousness, where God makes you righteous, instead of pointing out where you aren't righteous. Now, Paul knows what Philemon requires in order to maintain this status of acceptance, so he's going to address him and his wife and Archippus in this way. Verse 3, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, that isn't just like a hello, how are you? I mean, it's not that kind of thing. There's meaning to this. Now, I want to establish here, and I say this, I'm going about this a little bit different than I normally would, but I want to impress you with the magnitude of what grace does. See, that's why I'm doing this. I want to impress you with the magnitude of what grace does, because grace is generally viewed kind of in what we call a mamby-pamby way. God understands, and God loves you, and God will help you, and all that sounds really nice. But it's not thorough enough. It's unbefitting to teach people after that manner. Grace, again, when we talk about grace, we're talking about God's favor. We're talking about God doing something because he wants to do it.
Yeah. Amen.
Independently of you. So I'm going to quickly show how the grace of God does something. The grace of God is not like a blanket.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, people consider the grace of God like a blanket. Just kind of covers everything up, and covers the sin up, covers the bad attitude, the bad thinking. Grace kind of covers it up so God doesn't see it. This isn't the grace of God.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the grace of God is called great grace. That's Acts 4:33. Great grace was upon them all. What does it mean? It means grace in power exceeds the power that's against us.
Yeah.
It's great. So whatever you compare grace with, it's great.
Yeah, see? That's right.
But if you are not thinking about something being done, the word great, what is it, just an impressive sight? See, you can look at a tall building. In Dubai, they built the world's tallest building, hotel. And it looks great, but it really doesn't do anything. But after you looked at it, grace is greater. It's greater than that. Great grace. Grace also can be seen as evidence. Acts 11:23 says Barnabas saw the grace that was in them. How did he see it? It wasn't like a cloud over it wasn't like a halo over their head. It was the way they lived, the way they spoke. So it testified these people have grace. Grace can be seen. So when you don't see any evidence of grace, it's because grace isn't there.
That's right.
That's why there's no evidence. And grace is like an environment you get in, but you have to stay in it. You have to continue in it. Acts 13:43, they exhorted the people to continue in the grace of God. Continue walking in God's favor. Continue to avoid what agitates God. And what he already tells you up front, he will not countenance to get that stuff out. Get rid of it. God's told you who he's attracted to. He's told you who he's repelled by. Like the proud, he had nothing to do with the proud.
Yeah, that's right.
Knows them afar off. So any temptation you had to be proud, subdue it. And you can recommend people to the grace of God. Your grace is like a custodian. You're in the care of God's grace. It's a working trait. Acts 13:43, they commended them or recommended them to the grace of God. Here's somebody that grace can work with, this person. You know people like this. We've had some mentioned tonight, Brother David Hull, Sister Betty Cobb, Sister Mary Meyer, and you could think of others that we could recommend them to the grace of God.
Amen.
The grace of God would be like a shelter and a tutor to them.
Amen.
And we're saved by grace. Now listen, you were saved because God wanted to save you.
Amen.
Not because you were so attractive, but because he gets so much glory for doing it. Peter said early on, Acts 15:11, he said, we know at the beginning of the Gentiles, some of the early church had objected that Peter had been eaten with Gentiles. They didn't think that was proper. He said, look, they're going to be saved by the grace of God just like we are. See, so he saw that early on. And then, of course, the scripture says, by grace you're saved. Through faith. So you notice these things are all doing. They're doing something. And we believe through grace. If God didn't want you to believe, babe, you may rest assured you would not have believed. Believe through grace. Acts 18:27. Apollos helped them much who believed through grace. Yeah, there it is. Grace did. So if you believed, grace enabled you.
Amen.
To do it. And the gospel is the gospel of grace. Gospel of the grace of God. Acts 20:24. The gospel of grace, the good news of grace. Favor, or like the angel said, goodwill toward men. Well, some of these versions say that peace on earth toward men of goodwill. Whoa, who thought that? What school did this guy go to? There's several Bibles that read this way. Say the goodwill is the peace on earth toward men who have good wills. Yeah, that's how the Bibles read. But the only trouble was there wasn't any men like this.
Amen.
It's God's goodwill.
Amen. That's right.
Toward men. That's a gospel of grace, see? Goodwill. God's got other kind of will.
That's right.
People know as they can tell you, look, if God wants to destroy you, we got a whole world that can testify. Whole cities, Sodom and Gomorrah can testify. Whole city, Jerusalem, can testify. But the gospel is not a gospel of cursing. It's a gospel of blessing. It's a gospel of the grace of God. And, of course, we're justified freely. Yes, not only without cost, but abundantly by grace. That is, grace was equal to this need of being justified, thoroughly separate from sin and iniquity. Grace did that. That's how potent grace is. Grace did that. And we have access to God by grace. That text should be Romans 5:2. We have access to God by grace, the scripture says. That is, if God didn't want you to come to him, you'd never get there. But his favor is what's opened the door, giving you access to him. And there's an abundance of grace, Romans 5:17, abundance of grace. That is, whatever is against you, grace is bigger. So you get whatever it is. You just, whatever's against you, whatever's big, difficult for you, whatever that is, grace is greater. It's an abundance of grace. Normally something valuable is not in abundance. Like you don't have mountains of diamonds. You got mountains of dirt, you know, or coal. But grace, see, if something's valuable in the earth, you don't have a lot of it. Is doled out, you know, very sparingly. In fact, in economics, they have this phrase, the allocation of scarce economic resources. Mm-hmm. Something's valuable, you just dole it out in small measures. But grace is abundant. It's doled out in large measures, even though there's nothing can exceed it in value.
Amen.
Marvelous picture. Amen. And God is depicted as abounding in grace, Romans 5:20. So not only is it large, it keeps. Okay, you're here at this level here, and grace abounds, covers that. Then you come into a little higher level of temptation, higher level of risk. Grace abounds up over that. Then you get to another where you're facing trials that only strong people face, and grace abounds over that. See, grace is abounding. You'll never outlive grace or get in a situation where you're beyond what grace can do.
Yeah.
And grace reigns. Grace reigns through righteousness, Romans 5:21. So grace is like a king, like a ruler. So if you have adversaries, grace can reign over them, give you the advantage. And in Christ, we're under grace. Not under the law, we're under grace. And we're under the government of grace, the administration of grace. We're under the canopy of God's favor, of God's preference. We're there, and that we're in that tent, that tabernacle, so to speak. And grace gives people different abilities to minister, different measures of grace, gifts that differ according to the measure of grace. Romans 12:6. You see how grace does something. It equips this person to do this. It equips that person to do that. And both what they do complement each other.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, one makes the other work better.
Mm-hmm.
Grace does that. And grace makes us what we are in Christ, what we are. Paul says, I am what I am by the grace of God.
Yes, amen.
See, grace again works.
Yeah.
See, I remember Paul says, peace, a grace now to you, Philemon, grace. This is the kind of stuff that happens when grace is towards you. And grace is sufficient. If you have grace, you don't like need anything else. This is 1 Corinthians 12:9, what it should be. Paul had this thorn in the flesh. It was difficult to be born. Three times, I guess they were extended times, he besought the Lord, remove this thorn. In other words, it made it difficult to labor.
Mm-hmm.
And finally, the Lord said, oh, I'm not going to take it away.
Mm-hmm.
My grace is sufficient. My grace can make you equal to this,
amen,
what looks like a challenge.
Yes.
My grace can make you equal to it. Go ahead, brother.
I used to think that Paul it was inconvenient for him, but he thought it was hindering the ministry.
That's right.
So that's why he wondered. It wasn't just selfish. He wanted it gone for the ministry's sake.
That's right.
When the Lord showed him that he could actually enhance that.
That's right.
Yes.
It's a marvelous thing to see. Grace is sufficient. So maybe you have fallen on hard times. Things are happening that you wish didn't happen. And for a moment, maybe you've lost your bearings and you don't see that grace is sufficient.
Yes.
It can get away from you now. Mm-hmm. This can get away from you, so you don't. You may know if you were to have a test, is grace sufficient? You'd say, yes, it is sufficient. But in the crucible of life, you may forget that. But grace is sufficient,
amen,
even under the most severe of tests and trials. We are called into grace. I marvel, Paul said to the Galatians, you have so soon removed from him who called you into the grace of Christ. You were called into it. Grace is like a great big room chock full of supplies. How did you get in there? You didn't stumble on the door, let me tell you. You were called into this. Why were you called into it? Because grace, God intends for you to have what grace offers. Called into the grace of God. There are, of course, the riches of his grace. There's a dispensation of grace. God can take a special package of grace and he gives it to you and it makes you an exhorter or a teacher or someone that shows mercy or an apostle or a prophet or an evangelist or a pastor teacher or whatever. And this grace makes you.
Amen.
Not officially makes you that way, it makes you productive in that capacity. And you can know the grace of God. You can be able to recognize that this is God's grace. I am what I am by the grace of God. You know, I can see it. God favored me. That's why I'm what I am in Christ. That's why my sins are forgiven. It's why I've been given a ministry. That's why I haven't been taken out by the devil. God's favored me, see? You can see it, recognize it, know the grace of God in truth. And grace brings gifts like everlasting consolation and good hope through grace. God has given us everlasting consolation and good hope through grace. See, that's what delivered it. And grace, it's very heavily loaded with faith and love. Grace with faith and love. The grace of God was exceeding abundant with faith and love. So when grace comes, there's a whole lot of faith and a whole lot of love.
Amen.
Comes along with it. See, I'm showing how it does something. And grace teaches. The grace of God brings you salvation, but then it teaches you to deny ungodliness and worldly lusts. Live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. See, that's grace is what did that.
Yeah.
And you can be strong in the grace of God. You're justified by grace. Jesus tasted death for every man by the grace of God. Your hearts are established by grace. You're stewards of grace. You stand in grace. You grow in grace. See, that's... I just wanted to kind of give kind of a buckshot view of grace, how big it is, and how much it does. Now, the fact that Paul expresses a strong desire for Philemon to have grace confirms that its initial workings were seen in Philemon. See, the work of grace was seen in Philemon. Now, he's that it would abound. The grace of God made Philemon what he was. But the work's not done yet. You can always think of it this way. As long as you're in the world, the work's not done yet. What God's going to do in you is not finished yet as long as you're here. So that's why we say grace to you. Grace.
I remember the Barnabas arrived in Antioch, Syria. And he saw the grace of God working.
That's right. Saw it. Mm-hmm. It really bolstered him, didn't it? Yeah. Amen.
We went and found Saul and brought him back.
That's right. Now, sin doesn't have dominion over you because you're under grace, not under law. If we were under law, sin would have dominion over us, mm-hmm. even though the law itself was good and righteous and spiritual. Right. See, Jesus said, if the Son makes you free, you'll be free indeed. Mm-hmm. So you've got to reason this way. If I'm still being yanked about by the law of sin and death, mm-hmm. I'm not free. Experientially free. Let me qualify. I'm not experientially free. There's a lot of people that Jesus has freed, mm-hmm. but they don't know it. Because they've been taught ineffectively. And they haven't been told the right thing. So that technically they've been freed, but they're still sitting in a prison, even though it doesn't have any doors. Maybe you can remember when you sat in a prison that didn't have any doors. Finally, you just got up. You finally could just get up and walk out. Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, I've known people like this who all their lifetime been slaves to some form of sin. Just one day, they just quit. Mm-hmm. They just quit. They realize, I'm free. Just got up and walked out.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen.
So if you've been held back by something you wish you weren't held back up, get up and walk out.
Amen.
Just get up and walk out. Just come forth. Mm-hmm. Yep. Living people have no business in a grave or a tomb. Mm-hmm. Yeah, as soon as Lazarus was raised from the dead, he didn't set up shop in the tomb.
Amen.
Have some furniture sent to the tomb. Mm-hmm. You got out of there, made free. Yeah, that's what grace does. But God's people have to know this. Now, I didn't know this for a long time because we were not really allowed to talk much about grace. That was kind of, watch out, somebody think we're Baptist. Oh, yeah, I'm telling you the truth.
Yeah. Watch out, somebody will think you don't have to do anything.
That's right. So grace was kind of a, even though in your heart, how could grace be bad? I mean, but, you know, the doctors of the law must know. But see, you found out they didn't know.
Amen.
They didn't know.
Yep.
So it takes some time for some of us to really see this, mm-hmm. what grace, how effective grace is. So that's why the church has got to talk a lot about grace. They got to talk about grace. Mm-hmm. They have to confer it upon one. Grace to you, grace and peace be multiplied to you.
Amen.
They have to say this.
Amen.
To keep lively the awareness of what the grace of God does.
Davis, it's obvious. Paul talked a lot about it.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Yeah.
Brother Gavin, men can give other men freedom, but when grace gives you freedom, grace comes from God. So the freedom that you get from grace is freedom on the highest level possible.
That's right.
Yeah.
Amen.
This freedom isn't restrained like the freedom that we can get in the world.
So you're not in bondage to any man. You're not in bondage to any system. But as I say, some people, they didn't know this. Mm-hmm. Had to be announced. Jesus said, I come to preach liberty to the captives. To what? Yeah. To make the captives free? To preach liberty.
Mm-hmm.
To preach liberty to the captives. And the opening, to preach and the opening of the prison of them that are bound. Mm-hmm. I'm preaching that the prison's open.
Yeah. Amen.
Boy, this is good news, brethren. So peace, grace to you. See how much was said just in that word, grace be unto you.
Amen.
And peace.
Yeah.
Now peace equates to like quietness, repose, concord, calm. There's a number of, it's a sea is calm, you know, versus a raging storm.
Yeah.
It's a settling of the soul. It's realized by faith.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No need for me to be envious of the wicked.
Mm-hmm.
They seem to be prospering all the time, but I went into the sanctuary of God and, mm-hmm. oh, why? It calmed me down.
Yeah. Amen.
Don't you know a lot of God's people need to be calmed down with this peace? See, peace is indispensable if you're going to overcome the world. You're going to have peace. The scriptures speak of living in peace. That's 2 Corinthians 13:11. Jeremiah 34:5 says, dying in peace. Yeah. Jeremiah said you'll be dying in peace. And Acts 16:36 speaks about going in peace. That pretty much wraps life up. Living in peace, dying in peace, going in peace. So that pretty much wraps it up. If the scriptures speak of living in peace, then that's an environment we want to seek to maintain. Peaceful environment. An example of a soul without peace is given in Martha, Mary's and Lazarus' sister. And I'm given to understand this was not her normal manner, but this was an experience that she had. And Jesus said to her, "Martha, Martha, thou art careful, that full of care and troubled about many things." Now, she wasn't wearing her feet in on her coat sleeve. She had announced this to everybody else, but Jesus knew. He could say that to some people right here tonight. You're troubled about many, many things. And I know. You're troubled about many things. What should I do, Jesus? You need to get at my feet and listen.
Amen.
Mary chose the better part, and it shall not be taken from her. Through Isaiah, the Lord spoke of the wicked. There's no peace, saith the Lord, to the wicked. God will not let the wicked have peace.
Amen.
About the times things are going really smooth for the Trumps of the world, some kind of agitation.
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, yeah. Government official thinks they're right on top of the heap. Oh, some kind of... God will not let the wicked experience peace. There's no peace to the wicked. Again, Isaiah said, the wicked are like a troubled sea that cannot, when it cannot rest, whose waters cast up mire and dirt. There is no peace, saith my God, to the wicked. Well, I get it. You've probably experienced this mire and dirt ministry of trouble. Dredges up stuff that you thought had been buried in the bottom someplace and brings it up. That's the opposite of peace. Now, enough can't be said about the effects of peace. It stabilizes the soul. It stops the boat from rocking. It does. And if you're going to grow and be productive, this has got to happen. At some point, your soul has to calm down, and you can't be in a state of agitation. Now, I know that some of God's people, their households are like a troubled sea. There's something going on all the time. Now, these are legitimate people of God, but they're just agitation. Now, let me give you a little piece of personal advice. Don't invite people into your house that cause agitation. Well, I love them. Like I said, don't invite people into your house that cause agitation. You got enough to contend with without bringing it in and importing it in. Even when it came to someone coming to your door and wanted to share with you some message, that if they don't bring this doctrine of Christ, don't let them in. And don't say God bless you either. Don't wish him Godspeed. Why? Because you're bringing the element of agitation and turmoil in. Now, that's something you have to work out yourself. We don't have an easy list on how you can do this. Remember, the Apostle Paul says, to be spiritually minded is life and peace. So if you have a troubled soul and you have it for an inordinate period of time, everyone's going to experience it. So we're not talking about just being agitated, but when this is continual agitation, you've got to work on being spiritually minded. That means your mind is dominated by the things of the Spirit. Mm-hmm. It won't erase these other things, understand, but it will stabilize you. Mm-hmm. Yes?
As a matter of fact, when you're in these times, you're saying, because everyone does have some of those times, yeah. What you should be doing is learning from that time. If you're spiritual minded, you'll learn what the Lord's teaching you during this time, and then that time will be over.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I trust all can see this. To be spiritually minded is life and peace. Now, here's some things about peace I wanted to mention. That peace is a result of being acquainted with God. Yeah. It's how big God is. Acquaint now thyself with him and be at peace. Haven't you found it to be so? Haven't you found that as you are actually, you know more about God than you do about anybody else, that it has a calming effect on the soul? Haven't you found that to be so? Mm-hmm. It actually happens. Mm-hmm. Why? Because God really is greater. Mm-hmm.
Amen.
He is everything he says he is. Otherwise, this wouldn't be the experience we had. And peace is a blessing from God. If you don't have peace, God can, like, give it to you. The Lord will give strength to his people. The Lord will bless his people with peace. Isn't that good to know?
Yes,
he'll just bless them with peace. What do you need? I said, well, I need to have a sub-mega-dollar so I can buy a new house and a new car. I need health. I'm sick too much. How about this? I need some peace. You'd be surprised how many of your problems will go away if you have peace.
Amen.
It has a way of dissolving a lot of other things, or you see them with a little clearer light. You bless his people. You bless his people with peace. And peace is an experience of upright or righteous, godly people. Psalm 37:37, mark the perfect man. Note him now. And behold the upright. For the end of that man is peace. Mm-hmm. Now, you've probably known people that you've noted, and they were godly people, and you've taken, like, special note of them and admired them because they were consistently godly and so forth. But now, think about this. They got peace. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It goes along with being upright. Mm-hmm. Peace. They got peace. And they may be going through some experiences you can't figure out. How could they go through this? They got peace. Mm-hmm. That's how they're able to survive it. They have peace.
Amen.
Blessing from God. Peace follows the love of God's law. Great peace have they which love thy law. See, as soon as you love God's law, you prefer it.
Mm-hmm.
There's a peace that comes along with that.
Yeah.
Why? Well, because as you're considering God's law and his precepts and his judgments and his word, you'll not be able to do it profitably if you're agitated. So God, when you devote your attention in God,
Amen.
Gives you this peace while you're in this environment of his word. I'm sure you've experienced this. It's just our hope is you will recognize it, see? And you'll recognize, you know, I tend to be more calm and collected and have my senses gathered when I'm in God's word. That's peace.
Amen.
That's what that is. And God gave it to you. There's a way of peace into which we're guided. There's like a road. Peace is like a certain kind of highway. Here's what Zechariah said, to give light to them that sit in darkness and the shadow of death, to guide our feet in the into.
Mm-hmm.
To guide our feet into the way of peace. Now, if you try to find peace on your own, you won't be too successful. But if you approach it right, God will guide your feet, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right into that peace.
And this is why it is so incalculably valuable to do all things as unto the Lord.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Because at what point in time you are endeavoring to do something with God in the background, you're vulnerable to that
Amen.
Kind of agitation you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
That then compounds the problem.
Amen. Good
mm-hmm.
words.
Mm-hmm.
Peace relieves trouble and fear. They can't contend with peace. Jesus said, peace. Peace I give, I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled. Don't let it. Don't let it be troubled, neither but let it be afraid. Amen. See? Yeah. That's what peace. See, a peace. It's because it's Jesus, it's his own peace is what he's given you. How does Jesus feel about your situation? You suppose he's in a dither about your circumstances? Well, yeah, but he's Jesus. Yeah, but that Jesus will give you his peace.
Amen.
That's good news, isn't it? Our peace is with both God and Christ. We're being justified by faith. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And peace is an aspect of the kingdom of God. It's an evidence of divine rule. Kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. So these things confirm God's reign.
Amen.
And rule. And it's realized as you believe. That believing is the container in which peace comes.
Yeah.
Now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing. Mm-hmm. There it is. So if you want peace, it'll come to you, the container of believing. It'll stabilize your hearts and minds. You'll keep them. Keep them stable is the idea. And if you let it, peace will rule your heart and your mind. If you let it, it'll do this. So the critical need and benefit of peace is apparent, isn't it? So when he says grace and peace, so he's saying a lot. Well, all I'm trying to establish here is Paul was saying a lot when he said this. Now then these words, from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. These are like big exclamation points. Six times in Scripture, God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ are mentioned in the same sentence. God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Father and Son are mentioned in the same sentence 29 times. Showing how these two go together. See, the involvement of the Father and the Son, salvation in all of its aspects involves the work of the Father and the Son working together.
Amen.
It's got to be seen. Jesus doesn't take the place of God. He gives access to God. See, Jesus doesn't work independently of God. He carries out the will of God.
Amen.
Now, grace and peace are said to come from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ 10 times. That's stated in the epistles. And grace, mercy, and peace are said to come from both the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ 3 times. So nobody should ever seek grace or peace from a methodology or from a plan or from a program.
That's right.
It's from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And no one should attribute to a plan man created. No one should say that was a source of grace or that was a source of peace. I say this because these claims are being made.
Oh, yes, amen. If you go on the internet, you type in some of these programs, one of the things they'll boast in is that they can make you have peace.
Yeah.
Peace of mind and calmness. And and that's what you just said is direct contradiction.
That's right. It's from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We don't want to get accustomed to the terminology. From God the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Not a God, the God and Father.
Mm-hmm.
Not God and Daddy.
Mm-hmm.
God and Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. These are his three offices. Lord, that's his exalted. Jesus, that's his humanity. Christ is his fulfillment of God, God's purpose. The Lord Jesus Christ. That's the basis of their conferment. The basis of their conferment is what Jesus did that God required. So Jesus took away the sin of the world. That freed God now to give grace and peace. And Jesus, he reconciled the world to God. That freed God now to bestow grace and peace. He ended the law as a means to righteousness. Christ is the end of the law for righteousness. So he ended that. Now that made it right for God to confer grace and peace. And as the enthroned mediator, here's how it works. God gives the grace to Jesus, and Jesus gives it to you.
Yeah.
That's how it works. Amen. And if you want to get technical about it, God gives it to Jesus. Jesus gives it to the Spirit. Spirit gives it to you, and you take it by faith. So if you really want to follow the process, process through. Mm-hmm. See, God doesn't give you anything directly.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Comes through a mediator. Uh-huh. There's a mediator between God and man. There's one mediator between God and man. There's only one filter between you and God.
Mm-hmm.
Only one. It's the Lord Jesus. That's the only filter. Anyone tries to filter it through something else, like through a church or through a doctrine or some kind of teaching, there's one filter between you and God, and it's Christ.
Amen.
And he's the one, as a mediator, he delivers these things. Yes.
Yeah, it says in the scriptures that he that's joined to the Lord is one spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Now, You can see that it's only this new creature.
That's right.
The part of us that's joined to the Lord and created in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
That's the only one that is able to receive this grace. Because salvation is not only initiated by God and administered by God, but it requires God for us to receive it also.
Uh-huh. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. See, Jesus, God will not acquit the guilty. He will not,
Amen,
by any means,
right,
acquit the guilty.
Mm-hmm.
So a person has to get out of the category of guilty.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
Right. Now, no man can get you out of that category.
Right.
Only Jesus can get you out of that category.
Right.
He does it by justifying, you see.
Amen.
You can see it, I'm sure.
Amen.
See, because God, his nature will not allow him to overlook sin and pretend like it's not there. God can't even do this. That's why we thank God for the great salvation.
Amen.
Only God could have come up with this, to take all the responsibilities for sin, punish sin, curse sin, lay it on one person all at one time, then bring him back from the dead without the sin and righteously justify men. Only God can do that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, see, the gospel is God did do that.
Amen.
Amen.
And now righteousness and peace.
Mm-hmm.
All right, peace and grace and peace can be given to you. Brother Isaac, yes.
You made the statements of God in no way will acquit the guilty.
Mm-hmm.
Yet there seems to be a conundrum of sorts that, well, he has to save a people, but he can't save them in their state. So what's he going to do? Well, we all know he's going to send his son, the mediator between him and us. And I was, by that statement, that God would in no wise clear the guilty, but he has to save men. I was reminded in 2 Samuel 14:14, where it says in the latter half of the verse,
yeah,
he doth devise means that his banished be not expelled from him. So the Lord, in his infinite wisdom and his infinite salvation, did devise a means.
Yeah, here, and he tells us what it was. He took the sin away.
That's right.
In mass.
Uh-huh. Yep.
The Lamb of God, it takes away the sin, singular. John 1:29. This is how he did it.
Yeah.
He took the sin and he transferred it all in toto to Christ. Then he judged it in Christ and cursed Christ. And sin, once judged, will not be judged again. Then he raised Jesus from the dead, and the sin wasn't in that body. On the tree, it was in his body, but it wasn't in there. So that's how God did it. He took the sin away. Now, in the gospel, God is convincing men that he did do that. And men have wrestled with this through the years. This is a hard thing for them to believe. He didn't take sin out of the world. Didn't take it away from the world. It's right under our nose. He didn't take it away from the people that, so that it was not present in them at all. But it was taken away from the presence of God. So that now, listen, sin is not the issue anymore.
Amen.
Now the issue is the Son.
Yes, that's right.
That's the issue. What a person thinks of the Son, that's going to determine their destiny.
Right.
As far as sin goes, it's been put to death.
Been put to death.
As far as we're concerned, it doesn't dominate anymore.
If you don't see this, sin will rule you.
That's right.
So when he says grace and peace to you, all these things we've talked about, they necessitate this grace and peace, which puts a handle on salvation so you really know what God has done in Christ. He has really removed your transgressions from you as far as the east is from the west. Yeah, just exactly how far is the east from the west? Well, you got the northeast and the southwest, but you don't have the east-west. East and west can't meet.
That's right.
There's a line of demarcation. They can't be joined together. Yeah.
If that wasn't true, then it wouldn't show God's true character. Because of his righteousness.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right. Yeah, when you think, if you're ever tempted to think your sin's like not so bad, you remember what God did to Jesus when your sin was on him.
Yeah.
I believe his brother Roberts made a point of this recently, that if you think God can tolerate sin, he couldn't even tolerate sin being laid on his Son. He couldn't even tolerate that. But that's the only way he could get rid of it. Because
right.
if he judged it in us, we would have we couldn't have recouped.
Right.
We couldn't have come back like Jesus did.
Amen.
So there's no salvation without the effective work of God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, particularly in the dispensing of grace and peace.
Amen.
It's amazing how they're so abundant in this. Relatively little is said about them among professed believers. It's kind of amazing when you get into it. You see how what an extensive revelation has been given about these two necessary things.
Amen.
And if you have a word you'd like to add, Sister Barbara?
You're enumerating the things that Christ does. Mm-hmm. I was reminded the summation description of the manifold grace of
manifold
God.
Grace.
In that
Amen.
Same verse, we're exhorted to be good stewards of that.
Yes.
To be good stewards of the manifold grace of God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Yeah, it's grace and peace. These two go together perfectly.
Amen.
Because grace shows you that God saved you because he wanted to do it. This was something he wanted to do. Under the law, it was by your works of righteousness, whether or not you were going to have any of God's favor. But under the new covenant, God's favor or his grace is given to you, and as you see it rightly, that it's because of his desire, you'll have great peace.
Yeah.
It'll produce this peace in
you
because it's not by works of righteousness. And you would think, you know, I guess some people would surmise and say, well, then you won't do anything. Well, no, but the opposite's true.
Yeah.
When you see it rightly, that God saved you because he wanted to do it, and it generates this peace, you're one of the most prolific workers if you see it right.
Oh, amen.
Yeah, the Apostle Paul talked about the grace of God in truth.
In truth.
There's a grace of God that's not in truth, or people talk about it.
You know, Peter said, this is the true grace, not in which you stand.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I was thinking grace is so big, it's a real challenge to communicate it, though. But, you know, grace is an enabler. It brings all these things we talked about tonight, like peace and faith and hope and love, and enables us, you see, to negotiate these different situations we've been we come across. So it brings all these things with it.
Amen.
Absolutely amazing.
Yes, it is.
Consider it.
Now you can see how successful Satan's been in taking this gem away from a lot of people.
I'm persuaded that we need to. When we think of grace, we also need to think of power.
Oh, yes.
Wisdom.
Yeah.
Amen.
And its effect and its working. You know, that's right. It's not just a concept.
That's right. It's just not like a kiss on the cheek. Yeah. Oh, you are absolutely right. Amen. The power of God is, when it says great grace was upon them all, and he empowered.
That's right.
Oh, amen. Yes.
Wisdom, favor, wisdom, and power.
Oh, amen. That's good. Sister June.
Yeah, I think most of the confusion that men have whenever they're thinking about grace is they have thought about the grace of God working independently of the character and purpose of God.
Oh, that's good. Yeah, that's good.
Grace is not just some kind of power and enablement that we would consume it on our own lust or do a will that is apart from what God is doing. It's actually part of the process, if you will, of us being conformed to the image of Christ.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
So that we are doing the works of God. We're doing the will of God.
Mm-hmm.
We're being separated from the world as Christ, participating in that circumcision of Christ away from the world. That's where grace works. And because men are not really focused on knowing God and serving God and loving God, this grace is like, how do you factor that in? I don't know. Let's not talk about it. You know, it doesn't fit in any other way.
Yes, amen. Yes, Brother Aaron.
This commendation of peace has to do with a cleansed conscience as well. Isaiah said, there is no peace to the wicked.
Yes.
And the foundation of experiencing peace, like at least part of the foundation, is having a clean conscience and knowing that you're forgiven.
Amen.
And David expressed in Psalm 32 three things about a condemning conscience. When I kept silence about confession of sin, it says, my bones waxed old.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Thy hand was heavy upon me, and my moisture is turned into the drought of summer.
Mm. Yeah.
But the knowing that you are accepted in the beloved, then see that peace enables you to handle imprisonment and whippings and many other. The testimony that Fox gave in his Book of Martyrs comes to mind with this peace of God.
Mm-hmm.
Where men were not only able to undergo, to endure gruesome death, but choose it.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Remember how David once said, blessed is the man.
Yeah, that's right.
Whom the Lord will not impute sin, blessed is the man whose sins or iniquity is forgiven. That's contrast that with what the sense of guilt did.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Brother Ricky.
Yeah, this word of God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, that has been demonstrated in Egypt when Joseph arrived there and God brought him up to the throne, because Pharaoh owned it all, but Joseph distributed
it. That's right, that's right.
Now there was in that a mutual interest between Pharaoh and Joseph, as there is between the Father and the Son, because as Joseph distributed the corn, Joseph was actually buying the people and everything for Pharaoh. So he actually administered the corn in the interest of Pharaoh.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Now, Pharaoh did the same thing, see? He had an interest in Joseph being honored, and so he put the ring on him and brought him through town because he wanted all men to honor Joseph. See, and so he sought the honor of Joseph. Now that kind of relationship is there between the Father and the Son. And I say this because this encourages us.
Yeah.
When Jesus administers grace and peace, he primarily does it because this will redound to the glory of
Amen.
God.
Amen. Amen. Mm-hmm.
See, and so when you can realize that, it will encourage your heart to seek it.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Now think of the Father's interest in this, because he has committed all judgment to the Son so that all men would honor the Son even as they do the Father. So when you are seeking for grace, and instead of going to that procedure and that routine, you seek it in Christ, now this guarantees you're going to get it, because this is what the Father is seeking, is honor for the Son. So either way, it encourages your heart to seek for what God has to give.
Amen.
Amen.
Precious in this.
Yes, amen.
All right, we'll have a word of prayer. I'm sorry, Brother Dave.
Go ahead. I'll go back. It says, peace relieves trouble and fear. And I'll turn over. And grace and peace go together.
Yeah,
amen. I had thyroid surgery about a week ago, a little over a week ago.
Well.
And I got on the internet. And it said 10-15 minutes. I'm going, well, this is going to be a piece of cake. So they take me back, and I put on this gown. You lose your man.
I understand, yeah.
But put on the gown, and the anesthesiologist comes in and was telling us about the operation and what he was going to do to help me out. And I Then we got to talking, and I said, well, 10 or 15 minutes is not bad. I don't remember. But he said it's going to be an hour and a half to 2 hours surgery. I'm going, really? And, you know, I wasn't worried. God had taken that peace and fear.
Here you are. Mm-hmm. Amen.
But wait, you know, I'm laying there. I'm going, okay, hour and a half, 2 hours. And I know
rest.
Without a doubt it's the brethren.
Yeah.
It's prayers. Mm-hmm. To the Lord, give me grace and peace of mind.
Mm-hmm.
And the anesthesiologist said, don't worry, I'll take good care of you. I said, well, I'm not worried, I've got fire insurance. And it went over his head. He looked at me and he goes, fire insurance? I said, yeah, I'm not worried, I've got fire insurance. And I finally explained it to him. And I think it still went over. He said, what I'm getting at is, For me, this was a good example of peace.
Yeah. Amen.
Peace of mind.
So amen.
Whatever happened,
it was it.
It was okay.
It was the experience. You experienced it.
Yeah, that's right.
It's one thing to talk about it. When you experience it, now that's something else.
Yeah, I mean, that's
right.
Extremely comfortable with what was going on. And I know it was
that's peace.
My brothers and sisters in Christ. Yeah. I know that they were praying for me.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And your God is overseeing the whole thing.
Amen. Certainly was.
It's wonderful. All right, we'll have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we're very grateful for grace and peace, for the reality of these wonderful graces. We pray that we'd be more aware of them as we continue to live, that their presence would be detected by us, that we would rely upon the resources they bring to us. And we thank thee, Father, in Jesus' name, for the reality of grace and peace. Amen.